What's up, everybody? This is Jose from Florida Hood Blogs. While most of Southwest Miami is suburbs and really nice neighborhoods, there are a few hoods. And on this video, we're gonna tour the hoods of Southwest Miami. So when you think about Southwest Miami, you might think about mostly nice neighborhoods, but here and there are some hoods in Southwest Miami, and that is what we're going to explore today. Yeah, we're gonna see some really interesting contrast neighborhoods today. This is about what an average neighborhood in Southwest Miami looks like. A lot of people here come from the Caribbean islands. Like, see these houses here? They don't have metal bars on the windows. I talked to a family member that lives here in Miami, and he says for the most part, people are starting to get rid of the metal bars on the windows. It's really not needed for security. It's kind of more of a cultural statement. It's got three different types of mangoes on it. You can see the little orange ones, and then you can see the big red ones. So it's a grafted mango tree. In Naples, Florida, where I live, at least 80% of houses are within private gated communities, okay? Therefore, there's already a fence and a gate around the entire community. So within the community, you don't find houses needing to have that security. So I think just like these houses have metal bars on the windows, if you live in a gated community in Naples, it's the same thing. So I think a lot of people have a very serious prejudice against Miami because of the cultural aspect of it, and they assume it's dangerous and bad, and they just have this really negative concept about Miami. And I want to show you guys that Miami is a beautiful place. There's a lot of wealthy people living here, and it's not all dangerous. We are going to go to the hoods today and look at the hoods in Miami. But at the same time, you know, there are a lot of wealthy people here in these neighborhoods. And just like houses in Naples are inside gated communities. Like, look at this little house. This little house looks like it could be in Puerto Rico or Cuba or the Dominican Republic. It's a very Caribbean. They have an American flag outside, so they might be American. Here we have a nice little Cape Cod right across the street. Notice how this little Cape Cod doesn't have metal bars on the windows. So a lot of times people assume just because of the look of the neighborhood that it's a bad area, but it's totally not true. It's a cultural thing, you know. It's a lot of garbage outside. That's usually a good sign. When you see a neighborhood where there's a lot of garbage outside, it means that there's a lot of consumerism. It's a good area to live because you can make a lot of money. I've noticed that mostly in Naples, Sarasota, in some parts of Miami. What was the other place where we saw a lot of junk outside? Do you remember where it was?
Jacksonville.
Jacksonville and Bradenton, the two places where you see a lot of consumerism. Alright, everybody, we're in Southwest Miami, right outside of Little Havana. And one of the first hood things that you see, you know, hood looking. Now, when I say hood, I'm talking neighborhood. Doesn't exactly mean it has to be African American or black. That's so wrong of a mindset. One of the first things you see when you come into Little Havana, as far as, you know, coming into like hood culture, is these little shotgun houses. I don't know what originally they were built for, but these are just a nice little row of little shotgun houses here. This area is predominantly Cuban, so this is kind of like one of the most, you know, off the beaten path little areas, of, you know, little hood things. This is something you would expect to see like in Tampa or Jacksonville. These are called shotgun houses. Little Havana. This is Southwest Miami. This is mostly a Cuban neighborhood. A lot of elderly people in this area as well, but this is a pretty pretty rough little trailer park here. Mostly a lot of elderly people. As you guys know, housing in Miami is expensive, so it's kind of rough for the elderly people. You see a lot of elderly people out, but it's just a nice little trailer park from what, the 70s or something, maybe the 60s. Some of these are the older ones. Notice that they have metal bars on the windows. Lots of Cubans around here. A lot of old school people around. This is a really old school area. A lot of these people have pretty much been in this neighborhood for the longest. This is a more older and established community. Look at this little, I don't know what that is. Hello, this is Jose.
Hello, we're trying.
Man, these telemarketers are just crazy. They keep calling, but. Yeah, buddy. Here we have Haley's Dollar Store. So as you can see, there's Chinese food and also Honduran. Salvadorians, Hondurans have really taken over this little area of Miami. It used to be mostly Cuban. Now there's a lot of Hondurans and Salvadorians. We're in Southwest Miami near Little Havana. This is a small little area that I know about. These are shotgun houses, or row houses is what they're called. Now, this is something that you would normally find in a hood anywhere in the United States. These are called row shotgun houses. This area is predominantly Cuban, but it's just a little touch of, you know, hood in Southwest Miami. So this is one of the little tiny little areas that I think are interesting from an architectural point of view. This is definitely something you'd expect in Jacksonville or, you know, Tampa. It's more of a southern hood type of thing, but it's right here in Miami. Just these tiny little row houses. And I just wanted to show you guys this. Now, this is mostly a Cuban area, but it is real nice to see. Just a little touch of hood here in Southwest Miami. And right across there is Uncle Tom's Barbecue. I went there and I tried their barbecue, and I'm not gonna say it was amazing. For me to say barbecue is amazing, it takes a lot. So I can't say they're amazing, but they're there. seen this spot in a music video, maybe from Pitbull or maybe from Akon, but this mural right here is one of the most important murals in Florida. It says mainly of actors and other people from Latin America. You have Cantinflas from Mexico. You've got people from Spain, Mexico, from all the Latin American countries. Jose Marti, which is a poet from Cuba. You have just from all of Latin America. You have a Mexican mural. Rocío Dúrcal, Pedro Infante, Selena. So this is a mural giving honor and respect to all the cultures and important personalities of Latin American countries. You got somebody from Puerto Rico touching the congas. You have Celia Cruz from Cuba. If you are Benny More from Cuba as well, he's from the same part of Cuba that I'm from the same town. El Bárbaro de Ritmo. So there's a lot of Azúcar with the Cuban, also some American heroes as well. Abraham Lincoln, liberator of slavery. So it's very interesting that in this Latin American mural, you also have Abraham Lincoln, a mural for Abraham Lincoln, the liberator of slavery. So it says, Abraham Lincoln, liberator of slavery. Así como no serás esclavo, tampoco amo. And it says, you shall not be a slave or a slave owner as well. There's also the American Eagle, the Statue of Liberty. Right now they're closed, probably likely to the situation here. Most people in this area are still wearing their mask heavily. You also have George Washington, father of the American independence of North America. Cuando hables de Dios o de sus atributos, hazlo con toda la seriedad y reverencia. When you speak about God or his attributes, speak with all seriousness and reverence. La esquina de la fama. So this is the corner of fame, basically. So you've seen this corner of Miami, the corner of fame. This is in music videos. It's in documentaries. This is one of the most famous places in Miami, and right now it's still closed. They have great Cuban sandwiches here, and like I said, a huge cultural significance, this little intersection here in Little Havana. Now, there's a lot more people on the streets. It's kind of coming back to life. Most people you see here are wearing their mask. So since most people... Since most people are wearing their mask, I'm going to wear my mask also. I think that's just mask etiquette. If you're in a neighborhood where nobody's wearing mask, I don't wear my mask, but here everybody's wearing their mask. So I'm gonna wear it. You'll notice most people on the streets are wearing their mask. So this restaurant's not open right now, but it's very important to the...
Welcome to Little Havana.
La Pequeña Havana, ¿dónde estamos?
La Pequeña Havana.
Okay, mi hermano, gracias. Little Havana, so the people here are friendly, cool. Here's a giant mural. They have the seal of Cuba. La esquina de la fama, the corner of fame, basically. So this is a very important business, just awesome significance in the heart of Little Havana. Lots of other Mercado Havana, Cuban cuisine and bar. So there's a lot of important cultural things here going on. This neighborhood is awesome. If you come to Miami, you absolutely have to. El Taquito is another. Hola. El Taquito is another awesome little Mexican restaurant. Actually, when I was here last time, they hooked me up because I ran out of charge on my battery, and they recharged my my tablet for me. So they hooked me up last time. Really friendly people in this area. You'll notice everybody, absolutely everybody's wearing their masks. So everybody here is being as careful as they can. But if you come to Miami, you absolutely have to come to this district. This is the real Miami. You have to come here to Little Havana. Calle Ocho, which in Spanish means 8th Street. This is the Cuban, original Cuban historic district. You have to come here. This is the real Miami. I'm not gonna lie, I've been here at night. I wouldn't recommend being here at night. But in the daytime, it's awesome. You got to check it out. At nighttime, you're going to have people like hustlers. But in the daytime, it's totally safe. Now, I walk it at night. I don't care. I've been in New Orleans. I'm used to big city stuff. It's not any different than New Orleans. It's not any different than Atlanta. It's just like any large city. Any district like this in any large city at night may not be the safest place. I don't really care. I walk this district at night. But last time I walked it at night, I was approached by several people that were asking for money, or hustlers or whatever, with a story about their life. For some reason here in Miami, a lot of the beggars and homeless people are actually American. So the last time I hung out, I was here, there was a lot of homeless people. Most of them were American. So even though this is a Latino neighborhood, a lot of the homeless people are actually American. So that's kind of weird about Miami, at least this part of Miami. One thing I don't like about Miami is this tow away zone. When you come to Miami, keep an eye out on where you park, because they will tow you away anywhere in this area. That's the one thing about Miami, is make sure you watch where you park, because even though there's a lot of parking, a lot of times the businesses or parking places, they're like hawks. They watch these parking spots, and if you park in a spot you're not supposed to, they will tow you away like on the spot. Notice how everybody's wearing their mask around here. Like, life's gone back to normal, but people are still wearing their mask around here. So alright guys, so that's the tour of Little Havana, the Cuban district, that I definitely recommend you check out. Can't come to Miami and not check this district out. If you come to Miami, or you've been to Miami and you haven't been here, then you haven't been to Miami. Municipio de Santiago de Cuba. Municipality of Santiago de Cuba, and they got the American and the Cuban flag. Not sure what's going on there, but what's up, y'all? What's good? No, papi, no.
I have the cord.
I don't have it, papi.
I have the cord. I just got boom. That's it.
You got the cord?
I have the cord, yeah.
I'll pull up. I ain't got no insurance on this. All right, papi? All right, man. Cuban flag right there. I sent it to Brazil. Like, one block could be like $500,000 houses, and the other side of the street is hood. So this is Coconut Grove, and you're gonna see quickly how stark the differences is between one block to the next. So Coconut Grove, Miami. This is I didn't even know there were hoods out here. This is my first time out here. I thought this was all like, you know, suburbs and really nice houses, but in between all the suburbs there's little patches that are pretty hood. So let's explore this area. Coconut Grove. Very close to downtown. Now, we're all familiar with the downtown hoods, Northwest Miami, all over, you know, media, music, all TV, everywhere. You see a lot of stuff about Northwest Miami, but there are hoods in Southwest Miami as well, and that's what this video is about. We're gonna look at the hoods on the southwest side of Miami. This is Coconut Grove, and don't let the palm trees fool you. This is the hood. Here it says Cocoa Grove. Right there, spray painted. City of Miami, Billy Roll Domino Park. Close until further notice. So this park here is closed for now. Like a little front porch, like a shotgun house. It's nice too. I mean, look at this house right here. That's beautiful. So it is very contrast-like of a neighborhood. So it's kind of a really interesting mash of hood versus wealth, you know? It's kind of all been smashed together here. It's interesting. But I didn't know there was hoods out here. I recently had one of my subscribers mention, hey, you know, I used to live in Coconut Grove. It was really hood. And when you look at this area on a map, this is all suburbs and nice houses and stuff. And I was like, what, a hood in Southwest Miami? And then I looked it up on the map, and sure enough, man. But again, you're gonna notice it's very contrast from one block to the next too. So it's very, it's very interesting, you know. It's a very diverse neighborhood. Look at this little house. No trespassing. It's like a little. That looks like it came out of Alabama or something. It's very much an interesting neighborhood here in Southwest Miami. It's very contrast, you know. It's one neighborhood's nice, one on the other side of the road, it's $1 million house, and then here's, it's interesting. It's a very interesting neighborhood. Very, very interesting. I didn't know it was hood out here. Like, when you look at it on a map, I've never been out here. When you look at it on a map, it doesn't look hood at all. But then little sections of it are pretty hood, you know. Interesting area for sure. And it's still charming. Like, if you look at the design of the houses, if you look at the trees and all that, it's got a lot of charm to it, you know. Like, look at this big tree here. It's a big giant oak tree. Like it. I like this neighborhood so far. I like it. Look at this little shotgun house. That's awesome. I want to pull back around so you guys can see the apartment complex on the other side of the road. Give me a second here. Okay, so we're on the corner of Thomas Avenue and 37th. Contrast of this neighborhood. It's so, it's like you don't know if you're in a rich neighborhood, if you're in the hood. It's so contrast, you know. I love these little shotgun Florida cracker houses. Front porch, very southern. So far, I really like this neighborhood. I like what I see. It's right up my alley. It's got just a diverse amount of stuff going on, you know? Interesting area. Is in English, Spanish, and in Creole. It says it in all three languages. So all these parks are closed, but on the right side of me, there's a hangout spot, and there might be 50 people here. So it's kind of obsolete that the city's got all the parks closed for the people, but then people are still hanging out in hangout spots. It's kind of odd. It kind of defeats the purpose, really. Little shotgun houses. We're gonna keep it moving. There's too many people outside. Out the little shotgun houses. There's like four or five little shotgun houses there. You don't see too much of that in South Florida. That's really got to go a little bit north of Florida to see that usually. This looks like a Costa Rican or some other Central American flag on that car. I didn't catch what flag it was. Might have been Bolivia. No, it might have been Costa Rica. I didn't catch what it was. I think it was Costa Rica. Look at these little, again, back to shotgun houses. You just don't see a lot of that in South Florida. You see it in North Florida. When you get into Georgia, it's everywhere. And it stretches all the way back up to Kentucky, all to the south. But in this part of Florida, you know, before the invention of air conditioner, there wasn't much out here until air conditioner came around. Then people started to move to South Florida. So there's not even that much architecture before the 1960s in Florida. So what we consider old here in Florida would actually still be pretty much a normal neighborhood up north. But keep in mind, we didn't have air conditioner in the 60s. So before the air conditioning invention came around, there just weren't that many people in Florida, period. You know, it was all too hot and uncomfortable and unbearable. It was just too hot here. So there isn't too much older architecture here in Miami. This is a building like you would see in Northwest Miami. So this is kind of like a little chunk of Little Haiti right here. You know, the three-story building with no elevator, just staircases. You see a lot of that in Little Haiti, Northwest Miami. I didn't know we had that here in this part of Miami, so definitely a very interesting thing to see. It's kind of why I came out here, to see something interesting and different.
You're sleeping?
Katie's sleeping. Hold on, y'all. She's sleeping. Look at her. She's dead asleep, y'all. Oh man, you gotta love Katie, y'all. She's right here dead asleep, y'all. She's supposed to be on the map. Because what we do now, I'm getting more organized with these videos. What I do now is that I GPS on the map. I save this. I browse Google Maps and I save points. So when we do these hood videos, I already know exactly what streets we're gonna be on. I'm trying to get more organized because you know, this is more serious now. We got more subscribers. You know, we got more going on than before, so we're definitely more serious than ever with these videos. So as we get more professional, I've done that. I've gone on Google Maps and I'll save the video, you know, the places I want to go to. Check this guy's out right here, guys. So, you know, as I do these videos now, I'm much more professional. I save it on Google Maps, and then when we visit these places, it's already ready to go. And that really makes it easy so that when I'm, you know, it takes away the freestyle aspect of it, but it makes my videos better because I've already scoped out the neighborhoods before I go into them. So she's supposed to be on Google Maps telling me turn here, turn there. Look at these shotgun houses, guys. There's like four of them right next to each other. Just like you would see in Portland and Louisville, Kentucky, or in Macon, Georgia, or Atlanta, Georgia. It's just a nice little row of shotgun houses. I didn't know. Look at these right here. I want to show you. Look at how nice these are. One's green, one's purple. They really did a nice job. Two coconut trees out front. They did a great job of with these little shotgun houses there. But Katie's supposed to be on Google Maps telling me turn left, turn right, but she's sleeping right now. I think she just woke up. But yeah, she's supposed to be giving me a tour of the area, telling me where to go, but she's over here sleeping. She really wanted to get to Miami today.
That was so exciting.
Yeah, she was really excited about this trip out here. But then it rained out for what, two or three days of straight rain?
Yeah.
So we had like 2 or 3 days of nothing but rain. And in those 2 or 3 days of rain, pretty much, we had to stay home. So we had to postpone. A little chunk of Little Haiti. A little chunk of Overtown. This is what this looks like, Overtown. Look at these boarded up burnt out little apartments. This is something you'd expect in Little Haiti, but again, Southwest Miami. Very, very good. We're gonna go swing around the back of that block because the people in the corner were like, oh, he's got a camera or whatever, so now we don't wanna. This is the third time we swing around this little corner, so we wanna switch it up and roll up out of here. We don't want to overdo the same little area. It can make the local people feel nervous. And somebody brought out, one of the subscribers on the Palm Beach video brought out that a lot of times people are on drugs, so they're already paranoid. So if you know, if you do anything, you know, out of the ordinary, then you know, you have to just be really careful in areas where there's a lot of really high use, because people, this dude, he saw the camera, he didn't really care. So, but a lot of times people are just paranoid out of their mind, so any small little thing, like somebody with a camera, could really, you know, trip somebody out. You know, a lot of times if there's illicit activity in a neighborhood or something, they're really paranoid, and if they're drugged out, they could, you know, shoot at you or whatever, chase you down thinking you're, I don't know. You gotta be careful. So I need to start being a little bit more careful. I risk too much. It's not worth it, you know. I can do my videos without really without having to risk so much. Like right here, I got the side view on the camera so I can talk to you guys while we're driving through. But that's very obvious and conspicuous, where if I put the GoPro on the mirror, it draws a lot less attention, but then I can't talk to you guys while I'm recording. So that's a little Chevy truck. Katie, she wakes up from her sleep to tell me she wants a brand new Silverado. Living the good life, Katie. Big money Katie. Living the life of the rich and famous. Wakes up from sleeping at 12 in the afternoon to tell me she wants a new Silverado. Life is good for Katie nowadays. Life is good. Yeah, he smiled at me. That's pretty cool. We got a smile, guys. Look at that, Miami. We got a smile out of somebody. Wow. You just don't get that everywhere in Florida. So whoever that person was, if you know that person out here in the hood, give him a big hug, man. Give him a big Corona hug. Okay, we got a little deep spot up here, so let's Oh, this spot is deep up here. Yeah, that's what I mean. This spot is really deep out here. This is Douglas Road 37. Oh, it's a Jamaican restaurant. Yeah, I could definitely go for some Jamaican food. Oh, it smells good, man. Go for some curry. Curry goat. Oh, look at that Cadillac. That thing is sweet. West Coconut Grove. Some neighborhoods are very friendly. Like, it's really, you can't really tell. Like Ocala, there were some spots in Ocala that looked really, really hood. Yeah, when you start rolling through there, people are pretty friendly. And we got a row of little shotgun houses here I want to show you guys. In Ocala, it was really, really hood, yet everybody would wave at you. You know, people are really friendly in Ocala. Ocala is a friendly town. It looks more hood than this, but it's really friendly. Check out, this is on the corner of Broker and Fro, I think. Florida, maybe, I don't know. Just some really old school shotgun houses. The type of stuff you'd see up north, but we have it here in Miami, apparently. Just some really old school shotgun houses. There's a few more over here. Broker and Oak Avenue, Coconut Grove. That's a little older shotgun house. And keep in mind, guys, this is a hood, but this is surrounded by like absolute wealth. Like you go one block down and it's like Ferraris and Bentleys. I don't know what type of architectural design this is, but I saw it on Google Maps and I found it interesting. I wanted to show you guys. There's like 7 or 8 houses on this street that have this design. I don't know if it's from the islands or what, but it's just an interesting, kind of an interesting selection of architecture. They're making an addition right here, permits and all. But I don't know if it's like from the islands or what, but it's a very odd architectural style. But if you can see in the background, you can see the skyline buildings there. That's South Miami. That's all rich, you know, very ritzy little area right there. So here we got some, looks like little apartments, but they look very hood. Kind of almost look like projects, but they're apartments. I like how they did the stucco around the windows so that the windows wouldn't leak. I'm sure they did that to prevent having to replace the windows often. So these are little, kind of very hood looking apartments here. Important? Let me see here, it's my phone. say yes. Say hey, Sheriff, where would you like to do it? I think that's the guy from Michigan that I was working for a while back. Hello. Nice, you said hello. So very friendly people in South Miami. So far, everybody we've kind of ran into has said hello or even given you a smile. You don't just get a hello, you also get like a smile. That's awesome. You don't just get a wave, you also get like a facial expression. So people seem to be really friendly here. Very friendly people for the most part. I mean, I'm not saying everybody's going to be the same, but sometimes that, you know, goes by neighborhood. You'll have a, ooh, is that a barbecue? Oh, man, I could definitely go some barbecue. Are they open though? Oh, they're not smoking it right now, man. You know, around here, that barbecue's gonna be good. That barbecue's gonna be... Give me a second, y'all. I got a text message for work. One of my customers from Michigan's back down. And, starting to pick up again. I could really use the work. The more money I make, the more videos I can make. It's gotten to the point where... it's just been rough. The good thing was I had a little bit of a savings and I was able, you know, we took 2 months, basically 2 months without work, but I was able to get through those 2 months without work because I had a little bit of a savings, you know. And what's odd is we got all of our debt paid off, and as soon as we got our debt paid off, we got our savings through. And as soon as we started making a savings for the first time in forever, because to be honest, I didn't have a savings. It had all been basically spend, 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 spend. We finally got a little savings going, and this situation comes along. If it wasn't for that savings, we would have been in trouble because we're usually paycheck to paycheck. But right before the corona thing hit, for some reason, we paid off all our debt and just kind of started saving money. And boom, that situation hit right away. Weed around here smells like my armpits. Weed around here smells like my armpits. Weed around here smells like my armpits. What did they say? Yeah, I don't know.
Don't let us know.
Cool. He's good. Yeah. We had a lot of rain in Miami over the last few days. We were kind of in a drought, but these last few days it's kind of started to slow down. This is what most of this area of South Miami looks like. This is what most of the area in South Miami looks like. Usually it's kind of stuff like this, you know, beautiful mansions and stuff. Beautiful, very wealthy properties. Very, very nice, wealthy areas. And in the middle of all this wealth, you have a few little pockets of hood. And that's kind of what we're focusing on this video, is those small little pockets of hood in between all this luxury. Really, you have a lot of wealth here in this part of Miami. For the most part, it's some beautiful neighborhoods. 95% of landscape here is absolutely paradise. Beautiful landscaping, well manicured lawns. This is a great little area. It's very, very nice, especially the south region, South Miami, Southwest Miami, this whole area. The vast majority are beautiful homes. I don't understand. I do understand why, because people are racist and they're prejudiced. People have this massive prejudice against Miami, and they think Miami, because it's black and Latino, they automatically assume that it's dangerous, that it's bad, that it's poor, and that it's crime ridden. Take a look at these neighborhoods. These neighborhoods are most of these neighborhoods down here are about 40 to 60% Latino. I'm not sure on this exact area where I'm in right now, but the white population never exceeds more than 50% anywhere in Dade County. There's really not an area. Coral Gables has some white people. For the most part, these are wealthy Latino. And really a mix of people from Russia, Latin America, just a mix of people. And the vast majority of South Miami is very beautiful. I mean, look at this house right here. This house here, you know, like people in Naples, for example, a lot of times where I live in Naples, they say, oh, Miami is dangerous. It's scatter. Look at this house. Well, this house has nothing to envy any house in Naples. You could put this house in Port Royal, which is Naples' richest neighborhood, and it would fit in just normal. They got wealth here and money here and nice neighborhoods here, just like anywhere else. And you know, unfortunately, people have this negative stereotype of Miami that it has to be ghetto, that it has to be hood, that it's crime written. I tell people, hey, go to Miami, enjoy Miami. Oh, I can't go to Miami. I'm gonna get robbed. Look at these houses. You think these houses aren't packed with furniture and jewelry too on the inside? Just, this is a rich place just like Naples. But in Naples, so many times I tell people, hey, have you ever been to South Miami? Oh, Miami, I'm gonna get robbed. Look at this place. What are you talking about, man? So on this channel, I want to create a little bit of awareness of how mistaken people's prejudice are about this area. These are some suburbs that, for one, white people are starting to move in, because thankfully not everybody's ignorant, not everybody's stupid. A lot of people are, but not everybody's ignorant and stupid, and there's starting to be a lot of white people moving into Miami. A lot of people that moved out of Miami, I have a family that lives here, and we just had this conversation recently. He said a lot of people that, you know, young kids grew up in Miami, they went like to Ocala or Gainesville, you know, they went to North Florida for a while because they wanted something different. You know, they grew up, and they, a lot of those kids that moved out of Miami are moving back into Miami, and they got good education, they got very good you know, and this guy here, his, I can tell by his accent he's Colombian. You can tell by the way he's dressed, very wealthy. I mean, no different than any white rich guy in Naples. Only difference is he speaks Spanish, not English, you know. And I was talking to my family that lives here in Miami. They're telling me that a lot of the young kids that moved out of Miami, went to other places, got an education, got jobs, made money, move back to Miami once they get some money because they miss it, you know. They miss the restaurants, the nightlife. They miss the vibes. They miss the weather, the beaches. So this is a very fun place. Unfortunately, it's not a place you can enjoy if you don't have money. Like, see here, that, I think those Mercedes-Benz G-Wagons are $100,000 cars. That's a Moringa plant right there. That's kind of funny. Look at this little house. It's a beautiful little house. So there's this stereotype and this misconception that people have about Miami, that it's a bad place, and they're so mistaken. People who, young kids who moved out of Miami are moving back into Miami. Miami also has a lot of, like I said, white people from up north are coming to Miami and moving to Miami in larger numbers than ever. Miami metropolitan area and the city of Miami, out of all the major cities in the United States, Miami was the city metropolitan area with the lowest income like 3 years ago. However, in the last 3 years, that has changed drastically, and Miami's starting to become more of a middle-class area when it comes to income. So there's been a huge change in the income here, which Florida changes very quickly for the better. The income for the city of Miami has increased dramatically in the last 3 years. If you have time, look at that. Miami went from being one of the poorest metropolitan areas in the country to right now it's right about in the middle. So in the last 3 years, the income has increased dramatically. It's because a lot of people are coming into Miami, and Miami is becoming a better place. I really have a lot of people on my channel that anger me when they say stuff like, I went to Miami in 1980 and I got robbed. Yeah, I wasn't even born in 1980. That's a long time ago. People, you know, they came to Miami in 1980 or 1970, and they'll say something like, I got robbed in Miami in 1972, so I'm never going to go back there. Yeah, it's 2020. That's 40 years ago, people. You really think a place that you went to 40 years ago is going to be exactly what it was 40 years ago? Absolutely not. And Miami is the capital of Latin America. All the wealthy people from Ecuador, Colombia, Venezuela, Brazil, they're all here managing their international businesses. There's a lot of wealth here in Miami. And hopefully by showing you guys some of these nicer areas, we can kind of debunk these outdated and prejudiced theories about Miami. Miami is going to become a very attractive area. There's billionaires who live here. And you have people who are millionaires, okay? You have millionaires who say stuff like, I got Miami, oh yeah, Miami, it's gonna get robbed. You have millionaires who say that. But then you have billionaires who live here. So now you have millionaires who are pickier. You got millionaires who are more refined than billionaires. Billionaires have houses, properties here in Dade County. Grant Cardone, real estate, one of the biggest people. Well, if you watch him, he'll tell you, he's a YouTuber as well. He'll tell you all about Miami and living here. Lots of billionaires. Donald Trump, he has his property in West Palm Beach. That's about 70 miles north of here. Donald Trump has properties in Doral. Doral is another very wealthy area here in the Miami area. So while a lot of millionaires think that they're too good for Miami, there's billionaires that live here. From the wealth, or this is these are apartments, but they kind of look like projects. I know a hood when I see one. But okay, so we're one block away, and from here forward it starts to be hood. These apartments are pretty nice, palm trees and everything, but they're the old retro style apartments right here. From the wealth, we're gonna be right in the hood. You'll see how quick this neighborhood contrasts. Watch here. Nice area here, right? Watch this. Like literally like a minute away, watch. We're just gonna like drive a few blocks and you'll see the contrast. South Miami. So now we're in South Miami. South Miami is the central part of town. Absolutely wealthy. I mean, like Ferraris and stuff driving around. Then you drive like one block past all that and you're in the hood. So very stark and quick contrast of neighborhoods. Give me a second here. We got somebody on a bicycle going real slow. Can you see me? So just to show you guys how quickly neighborhoods contrast here in Miami. All right, there we go. We're in the hood. That's it. I mean, you went from like one block away. What's up, man? Like from one block away, it's all rich people. And then you come out here, and it's like a whole different story. By the way, everybody says hello here. Waves, nods, very nice. I love that. I like that about South Miami so far. These are projects or government housing in this area. There is some government housing in this area. I just don't know exactly which ones they are. It might be a mix between apartments and government. But this is South Miami. And let's get up in here. South Miami. But it's weird how quickly it contrasts from being a hood to being like really wealthy area. It's insane how quickly there's a transaction between hood and wealthy here. So I believe this is government housing. I might be wrong. They could just be apartments, but I don't have the time to look it up right now. But this is a nice little mural here dedicated to a united community. Learning, creating together. Val Carroll, 1979. And they have like these little beautiful tile parrots that they've put here. So this is South Miami.
just because a place is hood doesn't exactly mean it's a bad place. Hood is short for neighborhood, and what I've tried to also emphasize on this channel is swallow a mosquito. Oh my goodness, this is Florida. You're talking, you swallow like a whole mosquito. What I've tried to emphasize on this channel is that just because a place is poor doesn't mean it's gotta be bad. And just because a place is rich doesn't exactly mean it's good either. We've talked about how in wealthy areas there can be high drug use, and how here, this being a poor neighborhood, a lot of people wave or even give you a smile. They give you a facial expression. So just because a place is poor doesn't exactly mean it's bad. So, you know, somebody made a comment recently, like saying something along the lines of, it's almost like if this was a zoo and I'm showing it off. And that's definitely not the case. The culture of these places to me is important. May it be African American or Latino. The culture, the food, the architecture, these are things that are part of our community. But by showing people our neighborhoods, and that you can walk through these neighborhoods, people give you a smile. You know, rich people that drive around these fancy cars and live in these gated communities, they're not going to come to a hood like this and walk around, because they have a prejudice against this area, and vice versa. Okay, when somebody wealthy comes to a neighborhood as well, like, it goes both ways. Okay, when somebody wealthy comes to a place like this, let's say I was driving around in a convertible BMW wearing a golf hat, if that was who I was as a person, and I came to a place like this, then the people here might have a prejudice against me. So you see, that goes both ways. It goes between the poor people having a prejudice against the rich, and the rich having a prejudice against the poor. So by getting rid of that prejudice, and by showing rich people that you can come to these places, and that we have better food for better prices, we encourage people to bring their wealth to these communities, because these communities need this money. And if there's a line between the rich and the rich have the money. We, the poor people, have to get that money. And the only way we're gonna do that is if we can attract rich people to our businesses, to our neighborhood. So there has to be something that we can do to attract people to not be afraid. So with all that said, it's important for businesses, it's important for neighborhoods and communities to be able to become welcoming to outsiders, not be hostile to everybody that comes in your community, so that you can be able to bring that money that is much needed. And it's gonna take a lot of work for people to help that process to happen. Pretty much all the money and all the laws were to benefit them, so they have all the wealth, they have higher income, they have lower incarceration rates, just all the positive stats are in their favor. So they have the money, we need the money. How do we, as poor communities, disgusting. I literally swallowed a mosquito. Horrible. So how do we, as poor communities, attract white people, rich people in general, to our communities, so that we can get out of poverty through our businesses? Like here in South Miami, you see how friendly people are? Everybody gives you a smile and a nod. You know, they don't know who I am. I'm coming through your neighborhood with a camera, yet, oh, look at this empty lot, guys. Nothing but mango trees. Unfortunately, they're not bearing fruit. I don't see too much. There is some fruit. Just because a mango tree is big doesn't mean it's gonna produce more fruit. But anyways, but I love this empty lot, how it's got mango trees in it. So what can we do as poor people is what they've done here in Miami. You drive through here, you get a smile from everybody. That's why rich people are a block away from poor people, because the poor people aren't ignorant, you know? Palm Beach County is the same thing, but
try getting a smile of people there. That's why this area here attracts higher real estate values and has more investment, because the poor people here, you gotta have poor people where there's rich people. Look at this here, guys. It's like a party truck. So I guess this person's done a really good job of turning their culture into money. It says the party bus. They do party events. You have to attract money to your neighborhood. You have to have businesses that attract money to your neighborhood so that you can get out of that poverty. Like this person here has a party bus. You have to, you know, grab your culture and run with it. Make something out of it, you know? You gotta do the best you can. You have to try. I think a lot of times, if you're a poor community, and then on top of that, you're hostile to outsiders, well, you're just screwing yourself even more. Like here in Miami, you got rich people a block away from the hood. But here I am, an outsider, driving around with a camera, and everybody waves and says hello to me. That's why they're building. Like, I'm gonna swing around the block here so you guys can get an idea. Here's the hood right here. There's the hood, and directly across the street on the other side of the road, they're building a brand new building. See right here, famous chef Mango Man. You know, he's grabbing these people here in Miami are hustlers. They're grabbing their hood culture and they're running with it. That's why Wynwood, the graffiti and all that stuff, now rich people go eat there in Wynwood, which used to be a bad neighborhood. Now it's a rich neighborhood. Because they ran with their culture. They grabbed their street culture. The graffiti was the thing there. And they ran with it. And now everywhere you go in that neighborhood, there's graffiti. And that turned into, they ran with their culture. And they made something better out of it, you know? And that's why Wynwood now is where rich people go to spend their money. The people who had real estate there made money, made profits. The people who had a house in that little area, there's not too many houses there. But in general, you gotta make something out of your situation. And if as a community, you're hostile to outsiders, here's what I'm showing you guys. Look at that big building they're building there. They're building a brand new building. That's a lot of money. That's into the millions of dollars, right? It's an investment into the millions of dollars right across from the hood. But see, the people here, they're entrepreneurs. So this guy's got Mango Man. He's got a barbecue truck. The other person's got a graffitied out van and they got a party truck. Everybody. You know, that's the thing about Miami-Dade County. Everybody, what's up, y'all?
Hey,
people here are hustlers. This is an area where people, they're trying to do the best they can for their community. They're trying to do something with what they got. You know, they're not just, you know, they're not fighting the outside influences. And a lot, Miami has lost a lot of its culture to gentrification. I'm not saying gentrification is good, but I'm saying, you know, you got to make better for yourself. You can't just say, like a lot of the places I go to here in Florida, you know, people are downright hostile to outsiders, but then they're only hurting themselves, because people aren't going to invest money in a place. Here's another barbecue truck right here, you know, on this side of the road there's another barbecue truck, a little trailer with a barbecue truck. People here are hustlers, you know, they're making money, they're trying to improve their lives. See, this here, it's a little hood-looking apartment, but they painted it baby blue with some stripes. It's just that little thing gave it that much more appeal to it, you know? I've seen a lot of Texas plates here in Miami on this trip. Let's swing around the block here real quick. Look at this little house made out of natural limestone rock. So overall, what I can say about Miami is, you know, people here hustle. See the little barbecue truck? That's their culture. They're making money doing what they love. I mean, if you love music, make money doing music. If you love barbecuing, make money barbecuing. If you love, you know, partying, being a DJ, be a DJ. But do something better for yourself. How can I make this money? This white guy's coming to my neighborhood. He's got some money. How can I take this white man's money and put it in my pocket? That's the Miami mindset. That's why this area is going to get better and people are going to get rich. They're going to make money because they have the right mindset. If you don't have the right mindset, some of these neighborhoods in Florida are really poor. They don't have the go-getter attitude that you got here in Miami. 10 years ago, 5 years ago. But in the last 3 years, Miami left Naples behind. And if you want to be honest and see that, you can see that. I mean, poor people in Miami are living better than poor people in Naples, whether you want to see it or not. Is there more crime? Yeah, there's more people too. A whole different scenario. It's a whole different place, you know. But Miami has stepped its game up. The people here are go-getters and hustlers. They're trying to change their lives for the better. So, you know, Miami, 5-10 years ago, I felt that in Naples I was better. And a lot of people feel that, you know, they live in a better part of Florida than Miami because they're thinking what it was 40 years ago. In my case, 5 or 6 years ago, but for some people, it's 40 years ago. You know, you tell them, oh, Miami is horrible. I was there in 1980 and I got robbed. Yeah, that was 40 years ago. 3 years ago, 4 years ago, I could say Naples was better than Miami. But right now, money is moving here. The other thing is, like, businesses here move. Not only are we talking about, like, from a general point of view, businesses in Naples are, like, all furniture stores, all of the same crap. Restaurants in Naples don't last. And a lot of the restaurants in Naples are still around, not because their food is good, not because they have a lot of customers, but because the owners are really wealthy and they would rather lose money and keep the place open. Because I've worked for a lot of restaurants in Naples, and I've worked in restaurants where negative all the time in the red, all the time in the red. And they stay open simply because the owner is wealthy and he has his friends go there to eat. So he's trying to keep up some type of social appearance of having a business owner. But here in Miami, that doesn't happen. If you have a business here in Miami and it's not making you money, we gotta close. Businesses here make more money. Businesses here are more international. So, you know, the economy of Naples, Florida is artificial. This is a real economy here. There's international trade. Miami is a place that has so much going on. The economy here is real. This is a real economy. If a business doesn't make money, it's gotta close, you know? Another, you know, here the economy is real. International trade, small businesses, businesses that have been around forever, you know? If a business doesn't work, it closes. In Naples, you got businesses that haven't made money in 15 years, and they're still open because the owner of the business doesn't want to close it because it's going to make him look bad. So I've worked for companies in Naples that are losing money in the red, in the red, in the red. Always in the red, never making money. Orange is here earlier. We got to get back here again. Businesses that are always in the red, they're never making money, and they're still open continually, even though they're not making any money, because the owners, you know, they're wealthy and they want to uphold that social status of being a business owner. But overall, that's South Miami market. Nice. It might be part of the Latino culture. You know, it could be a cultural thing with the Latinos. Who knows, really? But overall, this park is open. That's nice. It's nice that the parks are open for the kids, man. Hello. It's nice. It's nice that the parks are finally open for the kids, man. So they didn't like the camera. But, I'm trying to exit here because I'm making one up. So we just bought on the side of the road for $20 about 2 pounds of lychees.
These are awesome. If you've never had a lychee, it's a beautiful tropical fruit. They taste amazing. And I don't think these are the best looking lychees I've seen, but that's what I'm talking about, Miami. It's all hustlers and go-getters. This is fresh from a tree in somebody's backyard probably. And this guy's gonna make several hundred off one of these trees. You can make several hundred dollars. If you got 10 of these things, you can make $4,000 by having a bunch of these lychee trees. So back to talking about hustlers and go-getters. That's all you got here in Miami. So I couldn't put the camera in their face because they're just little children that were selling this stuff. But in Kendall, Florida, I was able to get for $20 all these mangoes, two sapodillas, and homemade mango chutney.
Thank you.
All right, y'all, this is called a bandeja paisa. It's a Colombian thing. It's like a Colombian dish. You get plantain, steak, chicharron, white rice, and then you get your beans. And this is an arepa, which is like a cheese pastry. Let's get something to eat, y'all.